Namaste and good evening, everyone. Welcome to the 22nd session of the Tuesday lecture series presented by Vigyan Prasar for Vigyan Prasar Network of Science Clubs. I'm Dr. Nidhi Srivastav, project scientist from Vigyan Prasar, and will be your moderator today. It's my privilege to welcome the esteemed panelist of today's session, Dr. Prashant Kotgire, Associate Professor, Indian Institute of Technology, Indore. Dr. Nakul Parashar, Director, Vigyan Prasar, Dr. Arvind C. Ranade, Senior Scientist and National Coordinator, VIPNET Clubs, and Sri Sachin Narwadian, Mr. Vipin Singh Rawat from VIPNET team of Vigyan Prasar. I also welcome all the club members who have joined us for this session. Thank you, everyone. In the field of biological sciences, a scientific revolution took place in 1972 when a bacterium had manipulated to harbor DNA sequences from completely unrelated organisms. This is the time when genetic engineering was born, leading to the completely new kind of biotechnology where any organism could be asked to carry and express any gene of natural or artificial origin. Genetic engineering has already saved the lives of millions of peoples around the world, and the future of gene technologies is a true wonder. Our today's talk will focus on some of these marvels of genetic engineering. The title of today's lecture is Wonders of Genetic Engineering, and the speaker of today's talk is Dr. Prashant Kotgire, Associate Professor, Bioscience and Biomedical Engineering Division at Indian Institute of Technology, Indore. Our speaker will discuss a few important contributions of genetic engineering in the field of medicine, research, industry, and agriculture. The talk will be, as usual, of 40 to 50 minutes, followed by an interaction session. I request all the viewers, they can type their question in the comment section of the YouTube box. Once the session will be over, we will take your question. Now, to begin with, I would like to invite our director, Dr. Nakul Parashar, sir, for welcome remarks. Nakul, sir.
Namaskar. Mangalwar ke is... व्याख्यान माला के 22वें सोपान में आप सबका स्वागत है. आज आपके साथ मुझे ये साझा करते हुए हार्दिक प्रसन्नता हो रही है कि एक ऐसा विषय जो हम सब के लिए इस वक्त बहुत ज़रूरी है, बहुत हम लोग सब उसके बारे में बहुत चिंतित हैं और उसके बारे में जानना चाहते हैं. बड़ा सामयिक विषय आनुवंशिकी अभियांत्रिकी यानी जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग के बारे में आज हमारे मध्य एक प्रबुद्ध वैज्ञानिक इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी इंदौर से हैं, डॉक्टर प्रशांत कोटगिरे. पूरे विज्ञान प्रसार, विपनेट क्लब और तमाम उस टीम का जिसका नेतृत्व हमारे कुशल और अनुभवी वैज्ञानिक डॉक्टर अरविंद रानड़े कर रहे हैं, उनकी तरफ से मैं आप सबका स्वागत करता हूँ इस व्याख्यान माला के 22वें सोपान पर. उम्मीद है कि आज का व्याख्यान आप सब बहुत उत्सुकता से और बहुत ध्यान से सुनेंगे, क्योंकि जिस तरह से आज हम और सब तरफ हम आज को उस COVID-19 के वैक्सीन के लिए बहुत उत्सुकता से जिस बेचैनी से जिसका इंतजार कर रहे हैं, उसके बारे में, उसके पीछे जो कुछ है, उसके उसका रहस्य, उससे जुड़ा विज्ञान, उससे जुड़ी अभियांत्रिकी, उसके बारे में आज का व्याख्यान है. इतना सामयिक विषय और इतना रोचक विषय जिसको सुनने के लिए आज मेरे ख्याल से हम सब उत्सुक हैं, लालायित हैं. विज्ञान प्रसार के विपनेट श्रेणी का ये जो क्रम है, ये जो अभियान है, जिसका सूत्रपात डॉक्टर अरविंद रानाडे ने किया, वो एक बहुत अच्छी और एक यात्रा बन के निकल पड़ा है. अब तक के 21 जो व्याख्यान हमने अब तक ऑर्गेनाइज किए हैं, उन सब में हम सब ने बहुत कुछ जाना, समझा, और खासकर मैं तो ये कहूँगा व्यक्तिगत तौर पर मैंने बहुत कुछ सीखा है. और हर व्याख्यान माला अपने आप में एक अनूठा पुष्प है, एक अनूठा प्रयास है और एक ऐसी अनूठी सौगात है उन सब के लिए जो विज्ञान के बारे में और कुछ जानना चाहते हैं. विज्ञान और प्रौद्योगिकी को हम एक बहुत जटिल विषय समझते हैं, जानते हैं और उससे दूर रहने की थोड़ी चेष्टा करते हैं. उसको आम भाषा में आम आदमी तक पहुँचाने का ये प्रयास सराहनीय है और इसमें मैं अपने सहयोगी एवं अनुभवी मित्र एवं अनुज डॉक्टर अरविंद रानाडे को कोटि कोटि धन्यवाद और साधुवाद देना चाहता हूँ. और मैं एक नेतृत्व का जिस तरह से उन्हें परिचय दिया है, आप सब जानते हैं विज्ञान प्रसार नेटवर्क में जितने भी लोग जुड़े हैं, उन सब ने, हम सब ने उनके उस जज्बे को और उस पैशन को हमने देखा है और उसको हम सबका सलाम। तो मैं ज्यादा और वक्त ना लेते हुए आग्रह करूंगा कि डॉक्टर निधि श्रीवास्तव कार्यक्रम को आगे बढ़ाएं और डॉक्टर अरविंद रानडे हमारे प्रबुद्ध वैज्ञानिक प्रोफेसर प्रशांत कोटगिरे का अभिनंदन करें, उनका परिचय दें और आज की व्याख्यानमाला को शुरू करें। इन शब्दों से मैं अपनी वाणी को यहाँ विराम देता हूँ और उम्मीद करता हूँ आप सब आज के इस सामयिक विषय से बहुत कुछ सीखेंगे और प्रश्न करें जैसा कि हम नॉर्मली करते हैं और उसका आनंद उठाएं। इसके साथ ओवर टू डॉक्टर निधि श्रीवास्तव। धन्यवाद। जय हिंद।
थैंक यू सो मच सर फॉर मोटिवेटिंग अस। नाउ आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट अरविंद सर टू प्लीज इंट्रोड्यूस आवर टुडेज स्पीकर।
नमस्कार। धन्यवाद डॉक्टर निधि। आज के हमारे मुख्य वक्ता प्रोफेसर प्रशांत कोटगिरे, उनका मैं जरूर परिचय आप लोगों से कराऊंगा, बट उसके पहले जैसे एक संस्था के मुखिया जब आपके साथ हमेशा सदैव रहते हैं तो आपको भी काम करने की काफी प्रेरणा मिलती है और वो हमेशा से ही हमारे हर एक नए प्रयास को एक प्रोत्साहन देते हैं, ऐसे हमारे निदेशक डॉक्टर नकुल पराशर जी का भी मैं अभिनंदन और आज स्वागत करते हुए मैं ये जरूर कहना चाहूंगा कि हमारा जो प्रयास है आप सभी के लिए, जो एक आप बहुत ही कठिन समय में भी विज्ञान का प्रचार प्रसार करने में आपने खूब मेहनत कर रहे हैं, हमारे पास जिस प्रकार से रिपोर्ट्स पहुंच रही हैं उससे हमें बहुत प्रोत्साहन मिलता है। हमें बहुत अच्छा लगता है कि आप लोग ऐसे समय में भी विज्ञान का प्रचार प्रसार करने का काम बहुत जोर शोर से कर रहे हैं। आपने बहुत सारे ऐसे नवाचार भी किए हैं ताकि हम लोगों तक पहुंचे, उसमें कई सारी स्पर्धाओं का आयोजन किया है, कई सारे अलग अलग व्याख्यानों का भी आपने प्रयास किया है। ऐसे सभी विज्ञान के चाहते और विज्ञान क्लब के कोऑर्डिनेटर्स को भी मैं आज के कार्यक्रम में स्वागत करते हुए मैं आज के हमारे मुख्य वक्ता के बारे में आप लोगों से जरूर परिचय कराना चाहता हूँ। डॉक्टर प्रशांत कोटगिरे इज नो डाउट एन यू नो एस्टीम्ड प्रोफेसर एट आईआईटी इंदौर। हाउएवर बियॉन्ड व्हाट ही हैज डन इन द करियर, ही हैज एक्सटेंडेड हिज वर्क बियॉन्ड द प्रोफेशनल यू नो टास्क ऑफ डूइंग ऑल द रिसर्च एंड यू नो साइंस इन द आईआईटी। He is a part and parcel of one of our big initiative where Vigyan Prasar has joined as a joint partner as an Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan, and Dr. Prashant Kotgire is a part of our academic team. In fact, he is the brain behind one of the national science experiment. We call it as the biggest science experiment that every registered child is going to get a chance to perform. It's Eat Right. So basically it is on the hygiene, it is on the food that we eat. So this is a national experiment that we are going to try with all our Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan, and Dr. Prashant Kotgire is the brain behind it. His team is going to conduct this experiment in this month end onwards, and we will come to know various new kind of an information about the whole experiment. And each and every registered child, and I'm very happy to mention that in spite of this pandemic situation, more than 1 lakh students have registered across the country for class 6 to 11 in our Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan. And then I always feel like Prashantji is now part of our extended family of Vigyan Prasar, Vidyarthi Vigyan Manthan, and our joint partner Vigyan Bharati. So it is a great privilege for me also to introduce our Prashantji. And Professor Prashantji, as my director said, he is an associate professor in the Center for Biosciences and Biomedical Engineering at Indian Institute of Technology, Indore. Dr. Prashant obtained his graduation and post-graduation degree from Babasaheb Ambedkar Marathwada University, Aurangabad. And subsequently, to his master's in microbiology, he joined Wockhardt Research Center, Aurangabad, and worked on the process of development of recombinant therapeutics. He completed his PhD in 2007 in biotechnology, that is molecular biology, from Indian Institute of Technology, Mumbai, Bombay. He received his postdoctoral training at the Department of Molecular Genetics and Cell Biology at the University of Chicago, United States of America. During his postdoctoral training at the University of Chicago, he received the International Postdoctoral Fellowship Award from the Lady Tata Memorial Trust, then UK awarded for cutting edge research in the leukemia and related area in year 2008. Subsequently, in 2009, he received another very prestigious Irvington Institute's postdoctoral fellowship from the Cancer Research Institute, USA, which is awarded to only 16 fellows in the United States every year for work in immunology and cancer immunology. Dr. Prashant returned to India in 2012 as a Ramanujan Fellow and joined IIT Indore. He also served as the head of the department in biosciences and biomedical engineering at IIT Indore during 2013 to 2016. He was also awarded with the prestigious Eklavya Scholarship from the Government of Maharashtra for his excellence, for his excellent academic career, and his research work focused on the immunoglobulin gene regulation and understanding the molecular basis of somatic hypermutation of an immunoglobulin gene. His group's research, group's current efforts are on identifying the molecular mechanism of action and targeting of activation-induced cytidine dementia on the immunoglobulin genes. And I think the person who has thoroughly worked in the bioscience and biomedical engineering throughout his career. And I think the today's talk, in which the wonders of biomedical engineering will be the right topic, and we are really going to get all the I would say state of art information in this topic. And I'm sure the information that he's going to share to all of us will enlighten us about the research and development happening in the biosciences. और मुझे पूरा विश्वास है प्रशांत जी बहुत अच्छा हिंदी भी बोलते हैं, तो मैं उनसे अनुरोध भी करूंगा, क्योंकि हमारे विज्ञान प्रसार के जो क्लब के संयोजक हैं, संचालक हैं, वो भारत के कन्याकुमारी से लेके जम्मू तक हमारे साथ जुड़े हुए हैं, तो मैं जरूर आपसे अनुरोध करूंगा कि आप अगर बायलिंगुअल अगर आप चर्चा करके हमारे सभी प्रतिभागियों को आपके व्याख्यान सा एक ज्ञान का प्रसार करेंगे, तो हमारे सभी क्लब के लिए बहुत ही एक अच्छा मौका होगा। तो प्रशांत जी, वैसे आपको धन्यवाद अच्छा नहीं लगता है, बट जरूर आज के एक औपचारिक रूप से मैं आपको आमंत्रित भी करूंगा, और आपने जो हमारे लिए समय निकाला उसके लिए मैं शुरू में ही आपका धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूं, और हम सभी लोग आपके उद्बोधन की प्रतीक्षा में हैं। ओवर टू प्रशांत जी, धन्यवाद।
नमस्ते, थैंक यू वेरी मच अरविंद सर, थैंक यू वेरी मच डायरेक्टर सर फॉर दिस kind introduction, and it's indeed a privilege and honor to be there to popularize science and to outreach and interact with such a diverse, mixed and pan-India audience. We rarely get such opportunity to meet with diverse people. So thanks for this wonderful opportunity. As I'm told, we'll have, let's say, 40-minute talk, and then we will have some time to discuss, and we will co-learn together. I'll also learn a few things from you, and if I have some information to share, I'll share that. So let me begin with sharing my presentation. Are you able to see my slides?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Okay, so as Dr. Nidhi mentioned, that today's title of talk is Wonders of Genetic Engineering. In short, I'm going to tell some stories which some of you are already familiar of. You have probably read in your books, or you may have read some of these things in newspaper, in print media or electronic media. So these are small stories which some you are already aware of, and some are going to tell you what are the tremendous potential this genetic engineering has. And as Nidhi ma'am just now mentioned, that this is one such area, a modern area, upcoming area of science that has changed our life very significantly. It was able to save lives of thousands and thousands and lakhs of people. So before going into details of those stories, let me tell you about what you mean by genetic engineering. Now, genetic engineering means making changes in DNA in order to change the way living things work. Now, Madam also told that it started with the journey with Paul Burke. So this is a slide which is talking about three Nobel Prize awardees in the year 1980 in the area of chemistry. One of these three awardees was Paul Burke, and he was awarded Nobel Prize for his fundamental studies on biochemistry of nucleic acid with particular regard to recombinant DNA. Paul Burke got this award along with Gilbert and Sanger. These two people, they were contributing to the DNA sequencing process. And Frederick Sanger was one such person who got two Nobel Prize. Sanger got Nobel Prize in 80 for DNA sequencing, and he got another Nobel Prize for protein sequencing. So those people who are there and whose ambition is there to get a Nobel Prize, Sanger has kept the mark higher. He has got two, and you can definitely try hard and make sure that you also get another attempt for getting another Nobel Prize. Let's come back to Paul Burke. So Paul Burke, he studied on SV40 tumor virus. And as Madam rightly suggested, he started his work in 1972. And he was the one who was able to put one particular DNA from one organism into a bacteria. So this is what is genetic engineering. You are copying DNA from one particular organism, in this particular case virus, and that is expressed into an altogether different bacteria. And therefore, the name is recombinant DNA technology, or in an alternative word for that is genetic engineering. We are engineering the genes and regulating how these genes will be expressed, where the genes will be expressed, and when the genes will be expressed. All that is possible for us, and then use this particular technology for the benefit of humankind, for the benefit of nature, for the benefit of whole globe. Now, if you go into details, what are the different potentials of genetic engineering? We are able to create new crops and new farm animals. And I'll show you some examples how there are these new crops and new farm animals with very distinct and different properties altogether. You are able to make bacteria that can make medicine. That can make medicine, and we are able to use those medicine. Those are made in bacteria and save lots and lots of life. Going further ahead, along with genetic engineering and tissue engineering, we are able to grow human body parts. And you will see some of those examples that how you can have lab-grown body parts that can be used for transplant. The attempts are already made. It is not routinely used, but that has a potential to grow body parts in lab, and then that can be used for those new people. Going further ahead, you can also detect genetic disorders and prevent genetic disorder. You can do that by gene therapy. So there are some illnesses which are gene-linked illnesses, and genetic engineering gives you advantage of treating that particular disease before the child is born. Okay, so in short, we can change the whole human being. That's the potential of genetic engineering. Now, I'm sure all of you are aware about the word biopharmaceutics. The era has over where we had just tried small drugs, chemical drugs like paracetamol. Okay, now we have gone beyond that, and now we have started using recombinant drugs. And I'm very confident that each one of us, we have at least tried one of those vaccines which Dr. Nakul Parashar was talking about. Okay, so the major biopharmaceuticals are listed here, and this list is growing very fast every year. New and new molecules are added. These include blood factors, thrombolytic agents. They include hormones such as insulin, which are used for diabetic patient, glucagon, other growth hormones. There are hematopoietic growth factors like erythropoietin, colony stimulating factors, and some of these growth factors are life-saving. Erythropoietin happens to be the largest selling recombinant product. And since last 3 decades, it is there and it is used very, very potently for renal failure. Those patients who have kidney failure, along with the dialysis which is required for those patients, the kidney also function to make erythropoietin. And those patients, they are not able to generate their own RBCs. And therefore, doctor is recommending you to use erythropoietin. Earlier days, you will not imagine erythropoietin was isolated from human urine. And that's where you are purifying and using it. But now those days are over. Now we are able to use recombinant erythropoietin. And as in the introduction it was told, that a human gene is now cloned into altogether different organism. And that organism is used to generate and grow and get more of that protein. It is purified. And then you formulate it into injections, and those injections are given to the patient. Interferons, interleukins, and the very famous was hepatitis B vaccine, which I was referring to, that almost all of us who are vaccinated with hepatitis B vaccine, that vaccine is made by genetic engineering. It's a virus gene expressed into a yeast cell, and that's where we are going to purify from there, and that is used for vaccinating. And as Dr. Parashar mentioned about that, the COVID vaccine efforts which are going on, those vaccine efforts are also genetic engineering. We are using either the viral SARS-CoV-2's virus DNA or the DNA copied into mRNA, or you can directly use protein, which is a recombinant protein, and different companies are trying to work on all these different aspects using genetic engineering. And all of you have probably heard about the news last 2 weeks in international media that there are some companies who have claimed and they have proven that some of these COVID vaccines are more than 90% effective. More recently, these monoclonal antibodies are becoming very, very popular. And these monoclonal antibodies are also, again, another life-saving drugs. So as I told a minute ago, this list is growing very, very fast, and new molecules are applied for FDA approval, and they are going into market. And we have seen our family members who are using it, say, for example, insulin. Now, at least one relative in our family is using insulin, and that insulin is made by genetic engineering. Now, how does this growth hormone work and how they are effective? I just want to explain you by one example. Now, for example, the somatostatin is a 190 amino acid hormone, and that is used for growth. Okay, that is used for growth along with controlling so many different physiological processes. It also controls growth and metabolism. So if you have a human growth hormone gene and you put that into mice, and see the difference here. There are two babies shown here. There is this normal baby mice of same age, and this is a genetically modified mice of same age. But what has been done here is that you are able to clone a human growth factor hormone is inserted into the embryo on the mice on the left. So how do we do that? It's a very simple technique, which is called as generation of transgenic mice, where we manipulate the embryo at the blastocyst stage, where you take that blastocyst and inject that whatever DNA we want, here in this case, the human growth hormone gene, and then now integrate it back into that mice. And see the magic? The normal mice, which is growing at its regular pace, but because you are doing genetic modification, this guy is almost 2 times larger. That is the potential of genetic engineering, that by just manipulating one single gene from human and putting it into mice, you are able to get a different metabolism and growth dynamics of that particular mouse. Another very famous example, which all of you are familiar is about something called as BT cotton. There is a lot of debate going on about the ethical issues of BT cotton. We will not go into that particular detail. But what is happening here? You have a bacteria that's called as Bacillus thuringiensis. And one of the protein from that bacteria happens to be a toxin for the pests which are there on the cotton. So earlier days, what people used to do, they used to grow this Bacillus thuringiensis in a fermenter, grow large scale fermentation, isolate those spores, which will also have this cry protein. And then you spray that particular protein from Bacillus thuringiensis as a biopesticide. But that was a tedious job to grow it in a fermenter and transport. People thought, why not use genetic engineering and transfer this gene from bacteria Bacillus thuringiensis and put that into cottons? So again, we use those genetic modifications where that DNA from one source is now put into another source and then allow that particular cotton to express that particular cry protein into the leaves. As soon as that particular pest insect will start eating leaves of that cotton plant, it will also eat that cry protein coming from Bacillus thuringiensis and it will die. So you don't have to do spraying, you don't have to do fermentation, you just need to do genetic manipulations and therefore you are able to do it. So how do you transfer bacterial gene into a plant like cotton? We have to have a vehicle and there are lots of techniques and tools which are used to transfer a gene from Bacillus thuringiensis and then put it into a plant like cotton. So that vehicle used over here is something called as Agrobacterium timidifacius. This is a naturally infecting bacteria to the plants. It can cause tumors in the plants. The way we have cancers for us, mammalians, similarly, this Agrobacterium timidifacius can do tumors in the plant. So we exploit potential of this Agrobacterium timidifacius, use that as a vehicle, put that Bacillus thuringiensis cry gene, toxin gene, and then allow that to infect the cotton plant so that that gene is now transferred. So this Agrobacterium is used as a vehicle. It is used as a vector to transfer DNA from one organism and put into other organism. The way we are able to manipulate cotton, we are able to manipulate other plants also. So why can't we have edible vaccine? What do you mean by edible vaccine? No. We know that we have some kids in our family and they have their vaccination schedule. And it's a big job for us to go to hospital and get these kids vaccinated because none of us, we like injections. We can avoid those injections wherever possible. Say for example, for those particular infections which are going to happen into our intestine and we want to get vaccinated our intestine, you can modify the banana. You can clone a gene for that particular virus or bacteria, again by using genetic engineering, and allow this particular recombinant banana to express that protein, which is going to give you immunity, which is going to work as a vaccine for you. So instead of having those shots, which are very painful, and kids, even adults, they don't like to get vaccinated because of that fear or and pain of their shots. Now, you just need to go to medical shop who is now selling edible vaccine, that is banana. Now, these banana will not be available in our regular market because these are genetically modified. But they are now will be available into a pharmacy shop where you have a particular fruit for one particular vaccine and yet another fruit for another vaccine. So you just need to peel open the banana, you eat that banana and that's it, you are vaccinated. That's the tremendous potential this genetic engineering can have to create edible vaccine. There are other applications where these plants can be used as biosensors. Now, all of you are probably aware about, let's say, our neighboring country, Afghanistan. We share border from Gilgit to Afghanistan, and that Afghanistan is such an area where there is a highest density of land. And the kids in Afghanistan, when they go and play around in that particular area, they don't know the Cold War era, what USSR then and now Russia or America, they did in that. But those innocent kids who have not contributed to anything about that conflict now are suffering, and they just randomly go and play in the field. There is a hidden landmine there, and that landmine is going to blast, and that is going to create lots of issues. These kids, they don't have their legs and hands, so these are going to suffer the whole of their life. And just not these are going to suffer, their family is going to suffer. And to recognize that problem and to solve that problem, people have used genetic engineering. Now you have a plant, a genetically modified plant, where a green fluorescence protein is used, which can detect leached out chemicals from the landmines. Okay, so this green fluorescence protein is coming from a jellyfish, and I'll show you a slide about that in a while. So you have a gene from a jellyfish, which is an aquatic animal. You put that into a plant, create genetically modified seeds, and you spray those seeds into that particular area where there are potential landmines available. After a while, the seeds will grow. They form a plant, but there will be a promoter which is going to sense the leached out chemicals in that particular neighborhood area. And if there are chemicals from these landmines, that particular plant is going to express this reporter gene known as green fluorescence protein. So if you expose this plant with UV light, which is very easy, you are able to detect that yes, indeed there is a landmine, and then a trained soldier can go recruit that area, and he or she can deactivate that particular landmine. So by doing this particular technique, we are able to save lives of several different people of those conflict zone into different parts of the world. That's the potential of genetic engineering. So what do you do here? You have that green fluorescence protein, the gene coded for that, and that is now expressed into a plant. And that plant is now modified in such a way that it is able to sense the leached out chemicals from the land. So you have potential to put that into plant, you have potential to put into a bacteria also. This particular slide is telling you that how that P. globe plasmid is put into an E. coli, and that E. coli is growing on a plate. If it is growing on a plate, and if you expose that plate to UV, these colonies, which are tiny colonies of billions of bacteria, they start glowing that green fluorescence protein. The way it can be put into plant, it can be put into bacteria, it can be also put into different organisms, and I'll come in a while that how it can be put into a fish to develop environmental sensors. So how does it work? Traditionally, all of you, if you have studied Mendelian genetics, that genetics works on hybridization crossbreeding, where we were able to generate different varieties of wheat, different varieties of rice and pulses. But the genetic engineering is not believing on to the hybridization and crossbreeding, where you are leaving it to the chance that some combination will be happening and that particular combination is going to be favorable for. We don't do that. Instead, we go and do precision surgery. What do you mean by that? All of you know that all of us, we have, let's say, 23 pairs of chromosomes. There are 46 chromosomes in us. Each of these chromosomes is a book where a lot of information is written in terms of GATs. Random hybridization is just mixing of maternal and paternal chromosomes and generating something which is shown here is a mosaic structure. We don't do that. What do we do instead in genetic engineering? We open a precise book. In that book, we open a precise page. In that page, we are able to open a precise sentence, precise word, and a precise letter. And we just change that letter or a word and put it back the book again. That is precision engineering, which is available because of genetic engineering. And this year's Nobel Prize, which is about CRISPR-Cas technology. I hope all of you science lovers are following that news and you have probably read about what is CRISPR-Cas. That is one of those genetic engineering tools which is enabling us to do that precision surgery, to go and open a particular chromosome, particular gene, and particular codon and modify that in such a way that now you are not able to have a diseased gene, but you are able to have a healthy gene. Okay, so that is the potential of genetic engineering and how it is going to differentiate between the conventional hybridization or crossbreeding with the genetic engineering method. So you can expand that particular knowledge and apply it to many different things. So you can have frost-resistant strawberries. Now, strawberry is one such crop which grows only into cold climate. But when you have a cold climate, it can go below freezing also. People, scientists have developed and found an antifreeze gene from a fish. And this antifreeze gene is now inserted into a vector. You transfer that plasmid into a bacteria. And from that bacteria, you put that into the stem cells cells of strawberry. And now this LO gene from fish is now put into strawberry. And now that strawberry, when it is grown, now this is genetically modified strawberry, which has that particular protein, which is symbolized by this yellow color, which is giving you an unusual property. Now this strawberry is not sensitive for freeze. So this is now a frost resistant strawberry. So our farmer friends who are doing a lot of efforts in growing these produce, they are not going to lose many of these, their yields because of drastic change into weather, but instead they're able to get more production in those harsh environmental conditions. Now this genetically modified food possesses specific traits and tolerance for certain conditions. It is able to grow into high salt, less water condition, or it can have tolerance to different pest and insect. And it is very, very common into US. In United States, up to 70% of the processed food at a local grocery store contains at least one ingredient that is genetically altered. Okay, so you can have tomatoes which have larger shelf life. How do you do that? You are delaying the ripening by playing around with the enzymes of tomato. You can have genetically modified corn, which is now resistant to the insect and infections. And all these products, or some of these products, are there available into Western countries, and it is also coming into India. We just talked about one such example of BT cotton. One such amazing thing, which is India specific, can be done here. All of us know that despite lots of efforts by different agencies, there are pockets in India, especially into rural and tribal India, where our kids are not getting enough nutrition. Malnutrition is a big problem. These kids are not able to get enough vitamins, minerals. They're not getting ions. So some of our scientists, they have developed something called as golden rice. So what is this golden rice? It's a result of genetic engineering where pro-vitamin A, beta-carotene, is now expressed into rice. And if you give this golden rice to our kids in those affected areas, along with their regular nutrition, carbohydrate because of rice, they are able to get the pro-vitamin A, and their deficiency can be reduced just by using of genetic engineering. So can we end world hunger? The malnutrition or vitamin deficiencies can be tackled by using the genetic engineering in the right way. Going further ahead, what can be done? People have developed chickens that have no feeder, which has some experimental use. Genetic engineering has developed mice that don't have fur. So lots of cosmetic drugs which need to be tested onto the skin, you can use these nude mice, and then you are able to use and do the testing more efficiently without harming human beings. You can have genetically engineered fish that can grow much faster than the normal cycle. And this is an example of glowing mice where that GFP gene was not expressed into the line mine detecting seeds, but now it is expressed into mice, and you expose these mice and then you are able to see the GFP gene coming, the fluorescence which is coming up. So what do we do here? You have the embryo of these mice. We inject the GFP containing cassette by different genetic engineering tool, and that regular mice is now different, that whether because of that manipulation, GFP gene which is introduced into mice, you are able to use that mice for different experimental purposes. So how do they work? It's very simple. I told you that this GFP gene is coming from jellyfish. We use that particular DNA as a source, put it into a virus. Your virus is used as a vehicle. Vehicle to transfer one gene from one organism and put it into other organism. So that virus is used to infect the mouse cell, and now that mouse cell is having that new gene, GFP gene, that was originally present into jellyfish. And now this recombinant genetically modified mice can be used for different experimental purposes. So the way you can do manipulations into mice, you can do manipulations into fish. So you can have multiple different fish with multiple different fluorescent protein. You can have red fish, blue fish, yellow fish, or in short, you can have glow fish. What is the advantage of having these glow fish? People have tried and used these glow fish or fluorescent zebra fish as environmental biosensors. Now, all of you who are regular visitors of WebNet Club, you know that 1 week is dedicated to Namami Ganga project. And that particular department is doing tremendous work to make sure that our Ma Ganga is pure, is full of pollutant. But we know that that's not an easy task, and it needs tremendous effort. So genetic engineering can be also used for that particular purpose. We know that there are different pollutants which are put into our water bodies. We are the human beings who are more responsible for polluting these water bodies. And it is our responsibility to own it and to clean it. So how can genetic engineering contribute over here? It's very simple. You use genetically engineered fish where these fish will show the fluorescent light only after sensing the pollutant in that particular water body. So if there are pollutants which are coming from domestic water and there are some other pollutants which are coming from industrial water, untreated industrial effluent, and if their level goes up more than a critical level, these fish which are there into a barricaded area where it's a continuous monitoring of that water is going on, quality control of that water is happening. And very simple, you are having a camera which is going to capture the whether those fish are fluorescent or not. And that can give an alarm signal that yes, particular pollutant in that particular area of water is exceeding its limit. It is going above the threshold level, and that can be tackled by other ways, by closing down that source or treating that water in a better way. But genetic engineering has this tremendous potential where you can use this fish as a biosensor for different environmental pollutants. Imagine a life where you don't need to invest a lot of money into monitoring it, but just you have a different fish with a different fluorescent light for monitoring different pollutants. And just by doing that, you are able to monitor and control and sustain and make our water bodies, including Ganga, more better place and a cleaner place. There are other issues and other applications which can be used. That jellyfish gene, GFP, can be now put into a Christmas tree. And during Christmas, you can have a UV light which is going to be flashed and that is glowing on its own. You don't need to have artificial light which is going to do it. There are genes from bacteria that can kill these insects. We talked about Bt cotton. And there are genes from spider that can be expressed into a goat. That goat milk can be used for making spider silk. And that can be made into a strong and stretchy rope. You will not believe, I'm not sure about India, but in United States, the bulletproof jacket are made from the spider silk because this particular silk is the tougher silk than the stainless steel. Okay, all of you have seen the spider silk. That is a tiny thread, but it is able to take the whole weight of that spider. It is made up of protein, so that protein is coded by a gene. So you can take that gene from spider, clone that into a goat. Now, obviously that goat will not roam around into wild, but it will be there into a lab and contained environment. You get milk from that particular shell, and then you can make large quantity of spider silk, and that can be provided to our Indian soldiers. They also deserve safety and protection. And some of the genetic engineering lab in India are also trying to work on the similar fashion so that Indian soldiers will also get lightweight bulletproof jacket made up of these spider silk. You can also have other applications such as you can have a scorpion cabbage. What do you mean by that? You use the toxin from this scorpion and then clone that particular gene into our vegetable like cabbage. And now the scorpion poison is an insecticide. It will make sure that the pest which is probably going to harm the cabbage production and yield is now not able to do it. You can have, this is a proof of concept that you can convert a wing and convert that into four-legged chicken. Okay, that is possible because of genetic engineering. You can have human genes that can work into bacteria, monkey genes that can work in mice and earthworm, and tree genes work into frog or frog gene into rice. Any manipulations can be done with genetic engineering. That's the tremendous potential this particular thing can. So how can use of genetically engineering help us? By inserting a gene from human insulin into E. coli bacterium, and then ask that E. coli to make lots of insulin, which scientists and doctors can collect and use it for human application. That is what is happening. Right now, people used to use transplant from animals, such as pig, for humans. But there is a big chance of rejection because that is altogether different organism. And that rejection creates all sorts of different complications. Why can't we use that particular person's cells and use it to grow organisms? Can we use gene therapy to correct diseases and illnesses such as sickle cell anemia? So along with sickle cell anemia, like cystic fibrosis, where these are illnesses where there is only one gene or one amino acid is mutated. And because of that, these kids, they suffer for whole life. So those single gene disorders can be diagnosed, identified, and you can manipulate. You can manipulate the fetus, the embryo. And before the baby is born, you can correct that particular mistake. And that is possible because of gene therapy. So patient cells are taken where you use a virus for a vector, and then this red gene, which was a faulty gene, is now replaced with the blue gene, which is the wild type gene. Okay, so that is possible with gene therapy, where you are able to treat patients like cystic fibrosis or sickle cell anemia to or other illnesses where they are associated with a handful of gene or a few gene. So if we are able to do repair of genetic disorders, will we be able to cure cancer with gene therapy? And my answer is yes. My answer is yes. There are attempts here where people are trying to do it, but very soon people will know and they will have gene therapy solutions to cure cancer. When that will happen, when we will start using it, it's a matter of time. But this particular technology has a tremendous potential where you can just have this p53-like gene, which is now induced into that particular cancer cell. And you allow that p53 where it will initiate the apoptotic pathway, and you are able to cure that cancer cell and neutralize it and ask it to go on the suicidal. So that is possible with gene therapy. This is not an artifact. This is a real photograph. So what's going on here? This is a human ear kind of a shape, which is grown onto the mice. This is again a proof of concept to show that you are able to generate and grow human organs. Now remember that this particular ear is an ornamental ear. It is just showing the shape of ear. It is not able to restore the hearing disabilities. But it is telling you that genetic engineering and tissue engineering has a tremendous potential where you are able to grow organs. And this is a slide where I'm summarizing what are the different attempts people have tried. They have tried to grow human heart, trachea, bladder, kidney, even heart wall. Or they have engineered bone in the lab. And they are trying and testing it. They are not commercially available. A lot of work needs to be done, but these are not fiction. These are not imagination. These are real examples of how this particular technology can be used where you are able to grow organs. So you can have embryonic stem cell farm where you custom made that you want a ear, you want a liver, you want a heart, and then you visit that particular clinic after a few weeks, and then you can have their transplant surgery done. That is possible because of genetic engineering. So mixing of humans and animals is possible. This is a mystic beast that has a lion's body, serpent's tail, and goat's head. Although this is a mythological figure, but genetic engineering will probably prove that this is not a fiction. It is possible for us to do manipulation. In fact, in 2003, a scientist from Shanghai Medical University, they successfully fused a human cell with the rabbit egg. Okay, and this was the reported to be the first human-animal chimeras successfully created. Again, now application will have another issues, but there are these potential of this particular technique. Now in Minnesota, in Mayo Clinic, people have created pig, which is having human blood flowing all through its body. At Stanford University in California, experiment might be done very soon where mice with a human brain will be there. So I don't know whether we'll call it a brainy mouse or mousy brain, but these potentials are there. And this famous example, which all of you are aware about, is first clone, Dolly Sheep, which was born in 5th July 1996, where this is the Dolly, which was cloned from a somatic cell. So you have one donor cell, you use uterus of yet another organism, and then you create altogether new organism without fertilization. That is possible because of genetic engineering and human cloning. And this is just not restricted there, but a big industry started in US where people have started cloning their pet. It's altogether different culture where pets are part of their family and people are so affectionate about it that they are able to pay up to 50,000 for cloning of a cat. And this CC is the first ever clone cat with the surrogate mother, which is shown here. Okay, so the way you are able to clone the ship, Dolly, you are able to also clone any number of other organisms. You can hijack womb of one organism and use it for another organism. So people have used cow to give birth to a bison. You are also able to retrieve the endangered species, the extinct species by genetic engineering, and so that those organisms who are on the verge of losing their whole race, they can be saved. That is possible because of genetic engineering. I have just one or two more slides where I am going to leave it to you about some open question. If you are able to do cloning of sheep, goat, rabbit, mice, even cat, pet animals, are we also not a step away from cloning human beings? So UK scientists, they cloned the human embryo and it was the first clone of that particular thing, where people are also using embryonic stem cells. They are also using the other genetic engineering methods for therapeutic cloning. They're also using the reproductive cloning. So please try to understand, using cloning and genetic engineering for curing illnesses, avoiding diseases, is probably a perfectly fine idea. But if you start cloning for cosmetic purposes, if you start making tailor-made babies, you can have designer babies where there'll be labs, the way there are IVF labs, where they'll come with a catalog and they'll ask you that, what is the height you want? What is the skin color you want? What is the hair color you want? And what are the features you want? Nose like one particular actress and cheeks like yet another actress. What kind of society we are going to create with that is a big, big problem. And that's what I'm going to leave it to. What do you think? Should parents be allowed to custom build their children? Will it lead to happier parents or happier children? Will it lead to healthier people? Will it lead to more beautiful people? It will be an expensive technique. So will lead to only there being differences between rich and poor, because rich people are able to afford and get those custom-made and tailor-made babies, designer babies. What about poor people? Should scientists tamper with genes of unborn child to cure genetic diseases? Is it right? Is it unnatural? All these questions are ethical questions, and society need to ponder upon it. As I have told you, tremendous potential. I also told you that there is a debate about the BT cotton. There is a bigger debate about cloning human babies and having designer babies. And just 40-45 minute talk is not sufficient for us to have answer for very difficult questions. I leave it to you. I want you to think about these very difficult questions. Thank you very much for joining.
Thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful presentation and sharing some of the greatest achievements of genetic engineering. Genetic engineering is, I think, one of the tools that can make our life ease, provide ease to our life. It's such a powerful tool which can do, like, it has marvelous power. We can do anything what we want. We can have different babies, designer babies, and everything is possible with this tool. Thank you so much, sir, for sharing the technology with our viewers and with our WIPNet clubs. Now we'll take a few questions. The first question is, are genetically engineered food are safe to eat?
remember that this debate started with BT cotton. Now, cotton is one such plant which we are not eating. Okay. So, and a lot of debate is going on. We have not settled the debate yet. But when it comes to using genetically modified food, which we are going to use it for our daily consumption, all these labs who are doing it, they put in a lot of efforts to make sure that these products are safe. But remember that this whole concept itself is started, let's say, not more than 5 decades. 72 was the first recombinant clone. From there, we are in 2020. So therefore, we don't have much to say that how over the period of a long time, these things will going to affect our life. When it comes to food, we need to be extra cautious. And I thank you, that particular participant, to ask this question. But if you take proper precautions, if you make sure that there are no toxicities associated to it, I think it is fine. But if there is no proper testing done, we should make sure that thorough investigation and thorough testing is done before we go ahead and use it.
Sir, another question is that, like, it was said that genetically modified food leads to multiple resistance. How true this statement is, the drug resistance?
I don't think that's true, because many a times for creating these clones in our research lab, what we do is we use a vector, and that vector has an antibiotic resistance drug marker on it, and that is used for the selection. But when it comes to genetically modified food, they don't have these antibiotic resistance. Instead, they have metabolic selection marker. So maybe that particular reader can read in more detail and understand. Yes, for cloning, we use an antibiotic resistance marker. But those cloning and genetically engineered organisms, we don't throw in outside. We have very stringent biosafety guidelines in all the molecular biology lab. And we make sure that those organisms, they don't go. And those agri product and food product which are there in the market, where they don't use any of these recombinant technology or antibiotic resistance drugs.
So then the next question is, what would you suggest one should prefer, an organic farming or genetically modified crops?
Both things can go hand in hand. Organic farming is a substitute for pesticide, insecticides, which are highly toxic, the poisonous. We'll not go into detail, but we all know that how indiscriminate use of pesticide has led to groundwater pollution, and people are getting all kinds of illnesses. There's a train which goes from Punjab to Rajasthan to the city of Ajmer. That train is called as cancer train because of, again, that pesticides and insecticides and their hazardous effect. So the chemical fertilizers and these pesticide and insecticides, they have altogether very drastic effect, and we can avoid that by going through organic farming. But genetically modified, say for example, golden rice, if we are able to serve the tribal and the people in rural India by giving a rice, modified rice, where we are able to offer the pro-vitamin A along with their regular carbohydrate, that's a tremendous service. If we are able to generate edible vaccine, and if we eat those edible vaccine, we are going to just eat it once, we get vaccinated, and that's it. So organic farming should be very much promoted and encouraged, no doubt about it. These pesticides and insecticides are creating lots of health issues. And sooner we adopt to organic farming is better for us. but genetically modified will have altogether different applications. They are not opposite to each other.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, what are the genetic engineering treatments available for cancer treatment?
Remember that cancer is not one single disease, but it's a set of diseases. You can have one particular cell or a tissue, and there are four or five different types of cancer for that particular cell or a tissue. And for each of that particular cancer type, there could be dozens of reasons why that cancer is there. So for not all cancers, you have solutions. But for many other cancers, genetic engineering is used for diagnostics, for treatment, or to control growth of cancer. So I told you an example that people are trying to attempt. You can have P53 gene expression. It's a cancer controlling gene. It will regulate cells growth. And just by making sure that you induce P53 gene expression into a cancer cell, it will initiate an apoptotic pathway. So it's a long journey. It's a very big battle, but soon we will have cure for cancer using genetic engineering.
Sure, sir. The next question is, why is the presence of genetic engineered products or ingredients is not marked in food packaging?
That depends on the regulatory guidelines of a particular country. Many countries, they are very stringent about these marking. So if these are not there, let's say in India, there should be public pressure, and people should go by their choice. They should not be forced to eat unknowingly. And scientific community should also help, and the social pressure should be also there to make sure that our regulatory policies are such that we have proper marking and demarcation. Wherever there is a genetically modified food, that should be denoted, and people should make an educated choice. If they are willing to accept the risk associated with it, let them do it. But by hiding information, If that is what is happening, it is not fair, and we should avoid. I support that.
Thank you, sir. This is the last question for today's talk. That what being an active researcher in the field of genetic engineering, what according to you, what are the major challenges in this field?
Biology is one such area of science that is moving very, very fast. Sorry to say, but imagine, like mathematics or physics, how many new laws are discovered in the recent past? But that's not true. Here is one such area where we hypothesized something last year, and this year a new paper comes which demolishes that particular hypothesis and comes with altogether new hypothesis. So this is the fastest developing area. We have started studying biology very recently with modern tools. There is so much diversity in the nature. We not even know details about even 1% of living being, whether it is plant or bacteria or viruses. So there is a lot of hidden, undiscovered area, let's say into deep sea vent, in the ocean. We don't know even how they look and how they behave. Forget about identifying their genome and studying it. Same time, the world is also changing very fast. Despite having lots of medical interventions, new diseases are coming, and that is really, really creating problem for us. Say, for example, the new COVID situation, it came end of December. People came to know in China in January, and then it started spreading. Today we are in November. And it's a success story, but it's also a challenge. Within a year, we have a news that there are few dozen companies who are working on a vaccine, and hopefully we will have those vaccines available for us. But at the same time, At the same time, we also have to understand that such new and new viruses are going to come, and how, as a genetic engineering, as a biotechnologist, we are able to compress this duration and deliver the solution in shortest possible time. How we are able to predict outbreak of such diseases. So that is a challenge for us. I'm sure people will learn from the current pandemic, and this experience will be useful to tackle situation in the near future.
Thank you so much, sir, for your time. Now I would like to invite Sachin, sir, for a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Nidhi, madam. Thank you, Prashant, sir, for a nice lecture. And lots of new things are there in the lecture, which we doesn't know, like landmines plant, which are recognized landmines, and lots of new things. I also didn't know that things. So lots of ideas are there for writing popular article in your lecture. So I offer my thanks for giving your valuable time and energy. And I am thankful to Director Sir and our senior scientist, Dr. Arvind Sir also, for their inspiration and guidance for organizing this Tuesday lecture series. The VIPNET team, and at last but most important, is the participants, those who regularly watch this and observe and listen the lecture very carefully, as well as the post-telecast viewers also. I am thankful all of them too for their valuable time and effort. Thank you very much, sir. Namaskar.
Thank you.
Bahut bahut dhanyawad.